Oké, welkom bij Theosophy Talks, our Sunday afternoon presentations once a month. And today we will speak about mental epidemics, a very actual subject. There's a lot going on around the world, and I think we are thinking it is time to make a comparison with theosophical ideas on this level. I will give this presentation in three parts. Each part is something around 20 minutes. Then we have a break for 3 or 4 minutes, and in that break, or even before, you can send your questions. And the first thing what I will do is that by starting the next block, I first answer the questions, then give the next block and so on. So three blocks, and we start with the question, mental epidemics as a very general approach. If we make these comparisons this afternoon, we can do that from theosophical point of view quite easily, because we think throughout the whole universe there are universal laws. That laws works on all levels. If we speak about human beings or viruses or thoughts, it doesn't matter, that laws works. So that makes it quite simple, or at least much simpler, to make comparisons between mental epidemics and virus epidemics. Yeah? The only thing, if you start to compare, is what I called here the dimensions, the quantities, should be really in according to the area of investigation. In this case, if you speak about thoughts, this, the consciousness. What do I mean by this? On the virus level, we speak about physical distances as an instance. And if you want to do the same comparisons, we should think about mental distances. And can we express mental distances in physical dimensions, like 1.5 meter or 3 or 4 feet? No. But I will show more on the end of the third part how you can transfer this type of dimensions and compare them with each other. So that is a very important thing. The basic theosophical teachings work on all levels. So first, the question we have to address ourselves and try to answer is, what is mental? Yeah? That is the thinking process in the broadest sense. And that is a very important one. That is not only the physical part of thinking, but it is also the consciousness part of thinking. Yeah? Not only the intellectual part. A lot of people say thinking means the intellectual part, so that means 2 times 2 is 4. Now, if we speak about thinking, then it is not only the intellectual, then is it, let's say, aspects of thinking, lower, desire, vitality, and so on, but also higher, the buddhic, and the even higher than that characteristics of our thinking. So that's a very important one. So first we have to say a little bit about the consciousness, yeah? That is the ability to act and react. That is a very popular definition coming from Plato. We use it quite often. And we think that is a very easy to check for yourself and also a very easy approach. That means in theosophy, we say there is no difference between spirit and matter. It is all aspects of the same condition. There is no difference in between it. And the higher what we call spiritual and the lower what we call matter is just a state of evolution, a state of expressing. So, and that is an important thing we have to keep in mind for this presentation as well, that consciousness expresses itself according to the developed quantities. So that means that action and reaction from an atom to another atom It has been very simple. It is exchanging electron and starts to work together. It's a very simple approach, although the process in itself is very interesting. And if we see the same action and reaction between human beings, we see that it can be exchanging ideas, speaking with each other, discussions, and so on. And it is also an action and reaction, although from a complete different type of quality. But the general principle is the same. So it is not only that we see that action and reaction in the human kingdom. No, we see it in all the 10 kingdoms, from the most lower elementals tot the most highest, the gods. And special, the elementals, you have to keep in mind, because that is something what is an important aspect for this presentation. So if you see what is man, yeah, there we have a very simple definition. Man is coming from manas and means thinker. In a lot of European languages, you can see that the word man is coming in that language almost from the same root, from the Sanskrit manas, what means thinker. There's a certain process to expressing our consciousness. Yeah? So it's typical our characteristic. What I try to demonstrate a little bit later on, what is thinking? Thinking is seeing, perceiving, measuring, judging. So we have a type of image, I will explain it later on a little bit, and we reflect on that, and we have ideas about it, and we are working on that level and exchanging it. Keep in mind, if we speak about men, then we should realize, according to theosophy, we are only on the beginning of the human state of evolution. We just enter the point that the human evolution starts. And where do we stand? 18 million years ago, we start with the thinking facility, and still we have 2 billions of years ahead of us to make it completely developed and a full functional facility. So imagine yourself what type of very interested level of development we have still ahead of us. Yeah? The thinking is done, you can say, with a type of instrument. If I speak about instruments and senses, it is not needed only to think about in physical instruments or in physical senses. We have developed 5 senses up to now. Hearing, seeing, taste, smell, touch. That is what we generally expressed. Take the white line on the bottom of my slide good in account. It is not the eye that sees, but it is what see with the eye. So the physical instrument sends information to the brain. The brain does something with it and sends it in fact to our consciousness. And there we start to work with that information and give interpretations on it and so on. Yeah? Each of the senses has its own organ. Yeah? And have their own bandwidth. For instance, if you see that seeing has a certain spectrum, and we can only see, let's say, from the most lowest frequency, the infrared, the red, till the ultraviolet. But if you see for the bandwidth of hearing, that is much wider, and there we have in some cases, we have easily 5 or 6 octaves, and in seeing, we have only 2. So that means very important that the use of the instrument and the instrument itself can be much better developed than we have done. But I say already, we have still 2 billion of years to go to work it out and to polish it and to make it more useful. So these are the 5 senses we know quite well from the physics. But there are also higher senses still to be developed. That is something what starts to be used on the moment. And that is what we called, or what I called, two inner, mental and higher senses. Yeah. The sixth sense is what we called the body, the insight. And insight means that if you look to something, and look is a wrong word, but if you concentrate on something, you see a total picture and all interactions of what you look at it. All components show the way of working and interaction between them. And then we have the seventh, the atmic, what is called inspiration, and that is much and much higher than we are able to discuss on the moment, and that is something what gives us a total view over all things and makes everything, let's say, understandable and visible. But it is something what is still reasonably far away from us. Of course, each of the two senses has their own physical organ, is not yet in development. There are only, how do you say that, very rudimental parts available, but still we have to work a lot on it. Yeah, they have their own bandwidth. That is something we have to learn to express it and to extend it as well. And yes, it is a matter of time and using it to develop it much further. Using it is very important. It is like muscles. If you don't use them, they become weaker, not stronger. And it is the same with these two inner senses as well. We have to use them in the proper way, of course. A very important thing, if we say what is thinking, and our thinking facility is a sense, then thinking is seeing, observing. Thinking is viewing thoughts, images. Het appears to us as an image, but it is in fact something what we have built ourselves, an impression of something what we have observed or we start thinking about. If you're reading a novel, then you start already building a picture what represents the impression you get from the novel. Yeah? And that is what you are building yourself based on that particular information in the book. Yeah? Thinking is also perceiving, yeah, reflecting on it, yeah, getting it awake in our mind, yeah. But thinking is also sending images. If we think about an image and we start to discuss it and we give attention to it, we send it as well, yeah. And then that process of thinking is contributing images to the image gallery of our planet. And then I'm speaking not of the physical planet, but also of the astral light and the more, let's say, less material levels around the planet. Yeah? So the images we see, and that is what we have said before, everything is alive from a theosophical point of view. The images we see are living beings. And we call that in theosophy elementals. That whole thinking process is a process what you can easily compare with the normal transmitter and receiver in the technical world and what we are used to with our iPhone. An iPhone is a good example of a transmitter and a receiver. Yeah? It has a dynamic range, yeah, for having interaction. Yeah? And individual interpretations of the thought image we receive, so we get impressions and we give value to that, yeah? Yeah? And by seeing something through the corresponding thought images within our own mind awakes simultaneously the same type of impressions. So if we see something for the first time, we start to think about it, we build an image around something what we observed and we give immediately our interpretation, our values on it. Yeah? Think about a car. If you look to a car and you know the brands, then you have a certain impression. Oh yes, it's this type, it's that type. Another person looking to the same car, see the same brands, but can have a total different type of, ideas around it. He likes the car, and he knows the car, he likes to have that car, and so on, and so on, yeah? But that is something very dynamic, yeah? So, receiving touch images, yeah, can be done unconsciously, and then you are not aware of it. You receive that impressions, and they do something with you. And you can do it very consciously, so you can do, now I want to think about this, and now I want to create this, and I want to extend this idea. I'm making a novel, I have to prepare a lecture, I have to prepare a presentation, etc., etc. And then you start building images by images according to your attention, the subject, and where you are concentrated on. That sending and receiving is a simultaneous process, and that is a very important thing if you speak about mental epidemics. So we have to realize that if we see something and we have a reaction on it, immediately we start also to send out that reaction. Yeah? And that is something that we are very used to. And some people are very strong in it. They have always very strong spontaneous reactions about something, whatever happens. Yeah? But we have to realize we send that information as well. Later on, in the third part, we will see that it is a part of that mental epidemics can really be constructed and having an effect. Yeah? So what happens? If we do this, we receive something and we react on it, then we collect that energy, that information, that image to the thought currents around the Earth. Around our planet, there is a field in the astral light where all the ideas human beings are thinking are really stacked. And you can say, it is a little bit according to the quality of the thoughts. The lower, the very earth-directed thoughts are the lowest, the nearest to the earth, the more spiritual, are higher and far away from the physical earth. Yeah? So, and it is built by the quality of the conscious beings, what is receiving and reacting on the thoughts. So, simple thinking people give an other reaction than people that are very well trained in that particular subject. Yeah, and that is what I called here the most excellent one compared with the most grossest images. We contribute to the thought current around the earth. And they are powerful. They have a force in themselves. Yeah. So, if you look from this point of view, what are we? You can say we are a combination of thought images or thought elementals. So if you ask a person and you know him better, then you understand what type of ideas he has, what type of images he has, let's say, collected around him, what type of subjects he is feeling all the time. So you can imagine yourself that it is quite a dynamic thought image, thought elemental system, what is in fact what he expressed to the outer world. Composed by ourselves with a lower S, but also with ourselves with a capital S. So, and that is the quality differences we speak about. Yeah? We can adjust our transmitter and receiver. We can really tune and say, this is what I like to receive, and this is what I like to send, and not this, and not sending this. But that required training. So, if you start to compare the virus and the thoughts, the elementals, there are a number of things we have to take in account. And from theosophical point of view, the comparison is quite simple. If you are not trained in this, maybe it takes a little bit longer to consider it. But if you see the virus and we see it from science point of view, then they say it is a microscopic particle. Yeah, viruses become only biological active when it can be penetrated cells of a living organism. And theosophy say it is not a particle, it is a living being. Yeah, so it has the same possibility of action and reaction. And what is then untaught, from theosophical point of view, it is an elemental being that can only become active when it can be come in cooperation with a larger, in this case, thinking being. So you see, there is a parallel in the virus and in the thought elemental being. They do the same process on a different level. And that is an important thing you have to keep in mind. If you see the kingdoms, I spoke about already earlier, we have 10 kingdoms in the theosophical definitions. We have the three higher, the gods. Then we have the human kingdom, animal, plant, mineral. And then we have the first, second and third elemental kingdoms. And what I show here is that the virus is the lower part in the mineral kingdom. And the elemental thoughts is sitting in one of the three elemental kingdoms. So you see the distance is even from that point of view not too great. And maybe that is the reason that they can jump over easily to human beings as well. So it needs a being to manifest itself. It always lives, but if it is able to cooperate, it can become much more powerful. To be, let's say, in cooperation and to be able to manifest itself, it needs a suitable host. Yeah, it needs food. It needs a reproduction possibility and the possibility to jump over. So you see, compare viruses and thoughts, elementals, they are quite alike. This is the end of my first part. We take a small break. If you have questions, please send them in, and I will address them the first before we start with the second block.